Good afternoon to everyone, and welcome to another session of ISCB RSG-Turkey's webinar series. Today's talk will be given by Dr. Julien Dutheil. He completed his PhD at the University of Montpellier too. Through his thesis project, he developed a new probabilistic method to map substitutions onto a known phylogeny and use it to detect an alignment of homologous sequences and positions. After his PhD, he participated in the team of molecular phylogeny as a postdoc at the University of Montpellier. Then his postdoc career continued at the Bioinformatics Research Center in the University of Aarhus, Denmark. There he developed new models for genome analysis in a population genetics perspective. Now Dr. Dutheil continues his studies in the Department for Evolutionary Genetics at Max Planck Institute. His research aims at understanding the mechanisms of biological evolution at the molecular level. Research in his group combines computational with experimental approaches, population genomics, structural bioinformatics, and statistical analysis of omics data. The subject of his talk is the impact of protein structure on sequence evolution. We will have a question and answer session after his talk. So if you have any questions, please type your question to the chat box. And now I would like to call upon Dr. Dutheil to give his talk. Thank you.
Thank you. So I hope you can hear me, because it's a bit all new to me, this technology. And hopefully I'm not just talking. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, wonderful. So thanks a lot for inviting me and give me the opportunity to present some of the work we did in the group here. So I will talk about the impact of protein structure on sequence evolution, but that's a very broad topic. We're not going to cover all of that. But what I will start with is to tell you a bit why I actually think this general question of particular interest. And to me, that's because it's actually, in a way, belong to a much bigger question, which I think is central in biology. And that is to understand how the different traits of an organism are encoded in their genotypes. So by traits, I mean it can be many things. It can be disease, for instance, that with obvious medical applications. You can think of also quantitative traits like the eight, human eight, for instance, or if you think more like of agronomical applications like the yield of a crop. Also, host pathogen interactions are something I find particularly interesting. So from the pathogen side, for instance, the capacity to infect a host is also a very important trait. And from the host side, then the capacity to resist a certain pathogen is also a trait. So how these traits, or what we call the phenotype, is encoded in the genotype is a big question, and that's usually the realm of genetics to try to understand the link between the genotype and the phenotype. But it's also very relevant for evolutionary biology, because the phenotype level is a level at which natural selection will act and then sort the different genotypes in order to shape the genetic diversity of extant populations. So basically, understanding the link between genotype and phenotype allows us to understand, I would say, life in the present, for instance, to know what is the effect of a mutation. but also to understand life in a historical perspective with ultimate questions like how did life form emerge and how did they become what we can see today. So now if we look a bit closer to the, do we try to dissect a bit the link between a genotype and a phenotype. So if we look closer here, we can basically recognize that there are different levels of organization. And at the center of this are the macromolecules, so the proteins and nucleic acids. And these macromolecules, they are made of more simple residues by definition, so amino acids for protein and nucleotides for nucleic acids. But the macromolecules themselves also interact with each other in pathways. And that's this pathway that will then carry the function of the cell. So for the most simple life form, the unicellulars, then the cell is directly the organism, and that's where the phenotype will be expressed. For more complex life forms, like multicellular organisms, there is an additional layer where the cells interact with each other to form the organisms, and that's then where the phenotype is expressed. So now if we kind of extend a bit the analogy of the central dogma of molecular biology, we can say that there is a flow of information through all these different levels of organization from the genotype to the phenotype. And basically, one of the goals is to understand a bit how this information is transmitted and is carried through these different levels. And so with the we can say that the very first level here, the residue level, we understand it quite well, at least for proteins. And with the discovery of the structure of DNA and later the genetic code, we can pretty safely predict what will be the residues of a protein that are encoded in the genome. But further than this, we know very, very little. So how is this protein sequence going to fold into a tertiary structure? This we are largely not able to predict. How these different molecules are going to interact with each other to carry a certain function in the cell, we are also unable to predict. And so, of course, we understand things for, we do understand some things. I mean, we, with molecular biology, we could really dissect some particular pathway, particular genes, some particular proteins, and get some understanding on how they work. But we are really missing a general knowledge of how the information here goes through these levels. So that's why I'm generally interested in this. And for this this talk, I'm going to focus on the level 2 here, I would say, the level of macromolecules. And if we zoom again in here, we can recognize some kind of sub-levels of organization. So the structure of a macromolecule, it's can be decomposed into different levels. So usually we recognize like the secondary, tertiary, and eventually quaternary structure. And so we are going to see how these different levels basically impact the evolution of sequences. And more specifically, I will try to answer two questions here in this talk. In the first part, I'm going to ask, I'm going to focus on the adaptive mutations. So mutations that have a positive effect on the fitness. And I will ask how many of such mutations there are in proteins, and where are they in the structure. And in the second part, I'm going to focus on another mechanism, which we call molecular coevolution, and I will ask which position in a molecule are coevolving and why. So we will start with the first part, the adaptive mutations, and actually for this, each of these two parts, I will start by introducing some of the methods that we use, the statistical tools that we can use, and then I will show some results. So for the first part, the kind of technical challenge that we have is that we want to somehow quantify adaptive evolution. We want to know how many, which of the mutations are adaptive and which are not adaptive. So in order to measure this, we are going to focus on protein coding sequence only, and that's true for the rest of the talk. And we are going to use properties of the genetic code. So as you most likely knows, that the genetic code is degenerated. So you have 64 possible codons, but only 20 amino acids. So that means that several codons encode the same amino acid. And this has a very important consequence. That means that we can basically classify mutations into two types. You have mutations that will not change the amino acid. So for instance, that's shown here in blue. So if you mutate the third position of a TCG codon, you mutate the G into a C, then you have a TCC codon. And both TCG and TCC encode a serine amino acid. So basically this mutation doesn't change the amino acid, and we call that a synonymous mutation. But you have mutation like the red one here, where if you mutate the second position of a CCA codon, for instance, you mutate the second C into a T, then you get a CTA codon. And this CTA codon encodes a leucine, whereas the CCA encodes a proline. So there, this mutation has changed the amino acid, and we call that a non-synonymous mutation. So now if you look at all the possible codons and all the possible mutations, you have 576 possible single point mutations, among which 134 are synonymous mutations, 392 are non-synonymous, and then you have 50 mutations that involve a stop codon. So basically that means that on average, we expect three times more non-synonymous mutations than synonymous mutations. So now, how can we use this? The fact is that if you compare two sequences of the same gene in two different species, then you can count how many synonymous mutations there has been between these two sequences and how many non-synonymous mutations. And then if you divide this by the number of possible non-synonymous mutations and number of possible synonymous mutations, then you can compute two rates, the rates of non-synonymous mutations that we call DN, and the rate of synonymous mutations that we call DS. And a very important quantity is the ratio of these two rates that we call omega. And why is it important? That's because basically if you assume that all mutations are neutral, that none of them has basically an effect on the protein, then you expect both the synonymous and the non-synonymous mutations to happen at the same rate. And in that case, you have an omega ratio of 1, plus some possible sampling error, of course. But now if mutations are deleterious, they have a negative effect, then they will tend to be removed by natural selection. So then you will not see them in your sequences. And then when you will count the mutations, you will actually see much less non-synonymous mutations than synonymous mutations. And in that case, you will have an omega that is lower than 1. And on the opposite, if you have some mutations that are advantageous, then they will tend to invade the population at a fast rate. And then you will see many more of them than what you would expect. And in that case, that means you will have an omega ratio higher than 1 because the DN will be higher than the DS. And so that means basically that just by comparing two sequences, you can a priori say whether it has been evolving under positive selection just by measuring the omega ratio and see whether it's higher than 1. So that's all fantastic, we'll say. But of course, it's not as easy as that. And the problem is that, as you maybe can imagine, that in a gene, not all mutations have the same effect. So it's not like a gene is only evolving with positive mutations or with negative mutations. Usually you have a mix of everything. You have, of course, a lot of deleterious mutations, and you can have a few positive mutations. And by computing the omega ratio on the full gene sequence, then you're basically averaging everything. And since deleterious mutations will tend to dominate, then in most cases you will find the omega ratio to be lower than one. And that doesn't mean that there has not been any adaptive mutation. That just means that most of the mutations were non-adaptive. So if we really want to quantify the rate of adaptive mutations, we somehow have to decompose this ratio into two parts. One part that we call omega A, which is the rate of adaptive mutations, and omega NA, which is the rate of non-adaptive mutations. So basically what we need is a method that allows us to kind of estimate one of these two components so that we can subtract it to the DNGS ratio and then get the other component. So how can we do that? There is one possibility, which is to use actually population genetics, or more specifically to use polymorphism data, that is sequences of the same gene and that has been obtained in different individuals from the same species or the same population. And so the principle is that if you have an advantageous mutation, it will tend to spread very quickly in the population, so that in a few generations, all individuals will basically have this mutation and it will not appear as polymorphism anymore. So if we could compute some kind of DNTS, but not between sequences of different species, but between sequences within the same species, then this DNTS ratio will be essentially omega NA, so the non-adaptive part. It will be very little affected by adaptive mutations. And so such a ratio, we call it PNPS, bioposition to DNTS, where the P stands for polymorphism and the D for divergence. So PNPS, it's within species, and DNTS, it's between species. And so the idea is that if we compare for a certain gene or some certain locus, the DNTS and the PNPS ratio, then we can test whether there has been adaptive evolution in that gene. And so that's the idea that was first introduced by McDonald and Kreitman, and is still known today as the McDonald-Kreitman test, or MK test for short. But that's better, but there are still also some limits to this approach. And the limits are that, okay, in a gene, there can be both deleterious and advantageous mutations. But the truth is probably even more complex, in the sense that it's not like mutations are strongly deleterious or strongly advantageous. There is probably a full range of effects, including some that have only a small advantage or a small disadvantage. And such mutations that are slightly deleterious or slightly advantageous, they will not be removed or fixed in the population at a high rate. They will tend to persist in the polymorphism much longer. And so when you sample, you might still catch them. And so these mutations will affect the patterns of polymorphism, and they can therefore bias your inference of omega A or omega NA. Another thing that's important is that when population evolve, they are rarely evolving at a constant regime, let's say. Usually in terms of demography, I mean, they can go through some strong bottlenecks, or they can have some population expansions. And this variation of population size will also affect our inference of the rate. So basically, we need more advanced tools to account for these effects. And we can do this if we extract more information from the polymorphism instead of just taking the PN-PS ratio. And one way to get more of this information is to compute something that we call site frequency spectrum. And so the site frequency spectrum, it's basically a histogram of where we count all mutations in a gene, but we categorize them according to their frequency. So for instance, here, these are site frequency spectra for a sample of 13 individuals in 13 at least haplotypes. And so basically you have 12 type of mutations. You have the one that are present in one individual, so they are frequency 1 out of 13. You have some that are present in two individuals, like frequency 2 out of 13, and so on, up to the one that are present in 12 individuals. And so here you see the counts of these different mutations, and this is this distribution that we call the site frequency spectrum. So the theory predicts, and that's usually what you see in the data, that you have much more mutations in low frequency and much less in high frequency. So in the same spirit as we computed a PNPS, we can also compute a site frequency spectrum for synonymous mutation and a site frequency spectrum for non-synonymous mutations. And combining these two site frequency spectra with a DNDS ratio, then we can do quite advanced modeling. We can fit some kind of demographic parameters that will account for the variation of population size. We can assume an fully parameterized distribution of fitness effect, what we call a DFE, and fit it to the data, and then use this inferred DFE, a distribution of fitness effect, to estimate omega NA, so the non-adaptive part of omega, which we can then subtract to the omega in order to compute omega A, which is a quantity we are interested in here. So I didn't go into the mathematical details on how we do that, but these kind of state-of-the-art methods, they have a drawback, which is that we need a lot of data to be able to fit these complex models. And so usually, if you take only one gene, there is not enough mutations in the genes to compute a full SFS. So we need to combine many genes together in order to get enough information. And so that's why these kind of next generation methods, I would call them like population genomics methods compared to the classical population genetics approaches. So that's the kind of, I'm closing the methodological parenthesis. Now what I will show you is how we can use such approaches to answer the question from the start. And so the idea here is that we cannot, so as I say, we cannot apply this method to single genes or even less to single positions in a protein. So what we did here to circumvent that is that we tried to gather as many genes as possible in a complete genome for which we had a protein structure. And then we categorize the positions in all these protein structures according to some structural properties. So for instance, all the positions that are in a alpha helix, put them together, whatever the gene. All the positions that are at the surface of a protein, we put them together. And once we have sorted the positions, then we will fit our model on this set of positions, disregarding which gene they come from. So we did that for two very distinct species. One is Arachnopsis thaliana, so a plant, and the other is Drosophila melanogaster, so a fruit fly. So we have population genomic data set for these two model species. So that's 1,001 genomes for Arachnopsis thaliana, and that's the Drosophila population genome panel. In the Nexus 2 for Drosophila melanogaster. We also need an odd group sequence in both cases. So for the plant, that's Arabidopsis lyrata, and for the fly, that's Drosophila simulans. Then we applied a kind of same pipeline in both cases. We first extracted all the protein coding sequences. We removed overlapping transcript. We extract all the exons and then merged them to reconstruct the CDS. And then we extracted the site frequency spectra, computed the DN and the DS, and then fitted DFE model to estimate the DFE parameters and the rate of adaptive evolution, omega A. Then we did that by splitting the data according to different structural variables. So I will not have time to present all the results, but the variable that we studied are listed here. So that the secondary structure motif, that the solvent accessibility that we call RSA for relative solvent accessibility. We also look at intrinsically disordered regions. So that's parts of the protein that do not have a stable 3D structure. We contrasted active sites versus the rest of the protein. We also took into account the length of the protein, the expression level of the genes, and whether the protein is interacting with some molecular chaperone, just to give you an idea. So to show you the results, so here is a secondary structure, and you have on top the results of Arabidopsis thaliana and below Drosophila melanogaster. The first column is the DNDS ratio, and then the second is omega NA, and the third one is omega A. So total DNDS, the non-adaptive part, and the adaptive part. So column 2 and column 3 sum to column 1, basically. So in the case of secondary structure, we actually see a very little significant effect. So the DNDS ratio is significantly different, as shown here by the letters at the 5% level, between beta sheets, alpha helices, and loops. But when you look specifically at omega A and omega NA, in most cases, you have no differences. At least in Drosophila, there is no significant difference. In Arabidopsis, you see that beta sheets tend to have slightly lower rate of non-adaptive evolution and adaptive evolution, but it's very low significant level. That's not a strong effect. Something that has a very strong effect is the solvent accessibility, which is here shown on the x-axis. And you can see that it is positively correlated with all DNDS ratios. So the total DNDS, but also positively correlated with the omega NA and positively correlated with the omega A. So that means basically that the more exposed a residue is, when it's more at the surface of the protein, the higher chance it has to undergo positive selection or to have adaptive mutations. We found several other factors that are significantly correlated with this omega A. One, for instance, is the residue intrinsic disorder. So disordered regions tend to have a higher rate of positive mutations as well. And this somehow leads us to a small problem, because many of these variables are correlated. So disordered regions tends to be more at the surface of protein, for instance. Longer proteins tend to have less residue at the surface. So in theory, if we wanted to disentangle all these effects, we would have to analyze them together. But because we cannot estimate omega A per position, only globally for a certain cohort of positions, we cannot do that here. So what we could do is to analyze at least two variables simultaneously by categorizing all positions according to these two variables. To do that, we had to reduce a bit the number of categories. So for instance, we could not consider 10 classes of solvent accessibility, but rather just to categorize the residues as buried or exposed. And so we did that. We analyzed RSA, which is the strongest variable, simultaneously with each of the other ones. And so here on the left, that's just to give you two examples, we analyzed both protein length and RSA. So omega is negatively correlated with protein length, but it's positively correlated with RSA. And the thing is that when you put the two things together, the effect of protein length completely disappears. So you can still see the effect of RSA, which is here in light gray. So systematically, exposed residues have a higher omega A and higher omega NA than the buried one in dark gray. But if you take the curve separately, you don't have a correlation at all with protein length. So that means that,
Dr. Dutheil, we have a question.
I can see the definition of intrinsically disordered regions.
Yes.
So we have, there is actually a prediction algorithm. I think it's based on some machine learning, which you can run on the sequence and predict the intrinsically disordered. So you have a score. Of course, it's not perfect because we only use genes for which we have a 3D structure. And by definition, the intrinsically disordered regions don't have a 3D structure. But you can predict this region from the sequences. And so we use this this software. And then we had a threshold on the score to only keep the regions for which there was a strong confidence in the prediction. Does that answer the question? I will assume that it does. showing that if you account for RSA, the effect of protein length disappears. And actually, if you do so with intrinsically disordered regions, you see roughly the same thing. So the effect disappears in most cases. Actually, it's still significant in the case of Arabidopsis for exposed residues, but generally the effect of RSA always remained, but the effect of intrinsic disorder becomes much lower, so which suggests that RSA is really the main factor here. So here you have actually all the tests we analyze jointly: secondary structure and RSA, presence of active sites, and so on. And in all cases, the correlation becomes non-significant. Only the effect of RSA remains. So the exception is indeed its exposed residues for melanogaster in the case of disorder. So basically, that's kind of the main conclusion of all these analyses. That was that the main impact, the main driver of adaptive mutations in protein, or at least in terms of structural driver, that's the RSA. So exposed residues, basically all adaptive mutations tend to happen at the surface of proteins. And so we, of course, might wonder why. Why is that so? Why could that be? And the first thing we thought is that, the surface of the protein is where the active sites are. And so we looked at that, we predicted the active sites of the proteins, and we contrasted the omega A in regions of active sites and others, but we didn't see any difference at all. Then we thought the surface is basically where you have the binding sites. So the proteins, in order to carry the function in the cell, they have to bind with each other, and they then create some protein-protein interaction networks and so on. And so then maybe it's because if there is a new function, then it goes through the creation of a new interaction with an existing protein or something like that. So there we have has not much data for testing this. There is a bit of experimental protein-protein interaction data, and we looked at that, and we tried to categorize the genes according to the number of partners that they are interacting with. But we also didn't find an effect on this. But that could be because there was not enough data. But at least we cannot show that this could be the reason. But then what we did is we tried to categorize the genes according to their predicted functions. So for instance, taking gene ontology, annotations, and so on. And there, if we do so, if we rank here the different categories based on their rate of adaptive evolution, we see that the top categories are actually not at all the one we expected. Well, I don't know what I expected, but at least not that, because the top categories are, you have things that relates to ubiquitin system, to ribosome genesis, transcription machinery. So that's the type of function, and this is consistent in the two species. That's the type of function that I would typically call housekeeping. So the things that are really central for the cell and that I would expect to be extremely conserved, that's not where I would expect to have an adaptive mutation. And so that was a bit puzzling. And one hypothesis that could explain these two results is that if you think that these genes involved in basically gene expression and so on, they are typically the genes that will be hijacked by intracellular parasites, intracellular pathogens like viruses for animals, but also for plants. And in plants, you have fungal pathogens that will really go and hijack some of the host proteins and use them for their own benefits. And so basically that could really explain that most of the adaptive mutations that we see, at least by these methods, they could result from a coevolutionary harm race with pathogens. And so that would explain why they are at the surface of molecules, because that's what typically a virus or a fungus would be able to recognize. And also why these categories of genes in particular have a high rate of adaptation. So to conclude on this part, I would say that the main conclusion that we reach is that tertiary structure has a strong impact on the rate of protein evolution, so much less than secondary structure, for instance. And that's the level of this variation that's explained by tertiary structure is at least comparable to the variation between genes, as it can be explained, for instance, by variation of recombination rate. So genes that are in high recombining regions tend to have a higher rate of adaptation. But the effect, which is considered usually a strong effect in genomics, is actually much lower than the one of protein structure. And if we compare it to between species variation, then it's actually even higher. So a model that compares between species variations only explain a few percent of variance. One with recombination within genome explain 24% of variance, whereas one that accounts for tertiary structure, we are actually up to almost 90% of variance. So that's actually a very, very strong effect. And finally, the kind of as a question.
Yes. Yes. Esra asks that, do you think that your work can be applied human HLA system to reveal its current adaptive status?
So can you repeat the last part of the question?
Do you think that your work can be applied human HLA system to reveal its current adaptive status?
So if you would apply that to humans, basically, so it has been done. But the thing is that in humans, and actually that's true for all primates, the genomic average of adaptive evolution is like almost zero. You find that the rate of adaptive mutations is zero. So you basically have very, very little information then to contrast different categories of genes and so on. So it's a bit debated why it is so. There could be a lot of confounding factors that prevent us to really estimate the true rate of adaptive evolution. But there is some work which tried to do that, to try to get rid of all, make some very advanced modeling and try to get rid of some of these confounding factors. And they did find that the adaptive mutations in humans were actually mostly in genes that are interacting with viruses. So there is a paper that shows that. And so that's actually quite consistent with our finding. But we could not find so far as I know, any work that could really convincingly show some genes that were really involved in adaptation of humans, with the exception of the so-called lactase gene. But examples like this are extremely rare. Is that okay? Can I continue? Yeah, but so basically I was finished with this first part here. And so kind of the hypothesis that emerged from this work, but that is also consistent, as just said, with some other papers, is that there could really be here a role of coevolution with other organisms, in particular pathogens, to explain this rate of adaptation. And so the second part of this talk will be actually on coevolution. I don't know if there are more questions on the first part, maybe. No. And then we continue. So by coevolution, so usually when you would talk about coevolution, that's exactly like we said before. We think of coevolution between a host and pathogens, or coevolution between a predator and some prey. Or sometimes we think more like of symbiosis, like a fungi in plants, for instance. But we can define coevolution in a very broad sense. So if we have kind of a systems-like point of view, we can describe life as a hierarchy of systems, where you have different levels that are nested within each other, like we have seen residues in proteins in pathway in cells, and so on. And so one of the fundamental characteristics of biological systems is that the property of a system is not just the sum of the properties of the subsystems. Because these subsystems are interacting, then there are some emerging properties. And that's why, for instance, you cannot just so far predict the structure from the sequence alone. And from an evolutionary point of view, that basically means that the evolution of two subsystems will not be independent, because they are interacting as part of a higher level of organization. And this is this non-independent evolution that we call coevolution. So you can have species coevolving within an ecosystem, but you can also have genes that are coevolving within a pathway. And what we will be interested in this second part of the talk is that positions within a molecule can also coevolve because they belong to the same structure. So this particular type of non-independent evolution, we call it intramolecular coevolution. And we use the term to describe the coevolution of residues in a protein or nucleotides in an RNA. But again, for this talk today, we'll only talk about a protein. From a phylogenetic point of view, the two positions in a molecule that are coevolving, that means that they will tend to have mutations in a non-independent way. So if you look at the mutation that happened at two positions, they will not be distributed independently on the branches of the trees. So that means that when one position tends to mutate, then the other will also tend to mutate, for instance. So a possible genetic mechanism that can explain such patterns of non-independent evolution, that's what we call epistasis. So the epistasis, that means that the probability of a substitution at one site will depend on the state at other sites. So the probability that a mutation invades the population or get lost will really depend on which other residues you have at some interacting positions. And I will be even more specific, because what I'm interested in here is light. Is a particular type of coevolution, which we call coevolution per compensation. So that means that basically when you have a mutation at one position, it will have a deleterious effect. But this deleterious effect can be compensated by a mutation at an interacting position. So this particular type of epistasis is called reciprocal sign epistasis. And that means that the effect of a position will be either advantageous, the effect of a mutation at a position will be either advantageous or deleterious depending on the other states. And I will illustrate this with a simple example. So if you consider, let's say, two interacting residues in a protein and they are in contact, let's say, and you have one that is small, that's the position one, and at position two, you have a big residue. Now, so this is kind of a stable state, and there is another possible stable state, which is where you have a big residue at position one, but a small one at position two. So in these two cases, the protein is stable because in terms of stericity, that kind of works. But now what happens if you mutate one of these two positions? So for instance, if you mutate the small residue here at position one into a big one, then suddenly you have two big residues. And this can really lead to the structure to become unstable. So this will have a lower fitness as displayed here in this adaptive landscape. But now if you have a mutation at site two, which is turned this big residue into a small one, then you're back here, and then it's stable and it's stable again. So the first mutation at site one has a negative effect, but then the mutation at site two has a positive effect. An alternative scenario could be that there is first a mutation at the second position. So you mutate then the big residue into a small one, and then you arrive at a state where you have two small residues, and then maybe then they are not in contact anymore, and that's also not good for the structure, which become unstable, and then you have a lower fitness. But then this mutation can be compensated by a mutation at the first site, which is a mutation from turns a big residue into a small residue into a big one. And so here you can see that the mutation at site one, the red one, if it happens first, it has a negative effect. If it happens second, it has a positive effect. And that's the same for the mutation at site 2. So that's where we see this reciprocal sign epistasis. So that these type of mutations we are interested in, and we would like to be able to detect this. Can we see if we have an alignment of sequences between different species? If we have a phylogeny, are we able, or we would like to be able to say, okay, if I at these two positions, at this branch of the phylogeny, there has been compensating mutations. So we designed a method to do that. And this method is based on a procedure that is called substitution mapping, and which consists in mapping for every position of an alignment and every branch of the phylogeny, how many mutations of a certain type there has been. So that this quantity here, which is the number of mutations of type K, so for instance, alanine to leucine, at position I in the alignment and branch J of the phylogenetic tree. So to compute this quantity is not straightforward. There are several approaches. Basically, it involves at some point the reconstruction of ancestral sequences. So you need to reconstruct what were the sequences at every internal node of the phylogeny. And then if you have that, you can compute a quantity here, which is the number of mutations of type K on a branch of length T, knowing the ancestral state A and on the bottom of the branch and the ancestral state B at the top of the branch. So we can use Markov models to compute this quantity. It's not trivial, but we have analytical solutions for that. And then we can integrate this quantity over all possible ancestral states, which give us then a statistical map of the various mutations and where and when they happened. Something that we will do here is that we will, because we're going to work on proteins, we will consider a certain biochemical property, so an index that give for all the 20 amino acids a certain value, like the volume of the residues or the polarity or the charge. And then with this index, we can integrate it over the substitution maps. And this gives us something like this. So it's, I know the figure is not wonderful here, but it's a big image where you have each column here is one position in a protein, one residue, and each line is one branch in the phylogeny. And then when you have a spot that is blue, that means that in that case, it's a polarity that has been mapped. So when you see something blue, that means that at this particular position and this branch of the phylogeny, there has been a decrease in polarity. There has been some mutations here that have change the amino acid into one that had a lower polarity. So that means a more hydrophobic residue, basically. And on the contrary, when there is a red point, that means that on this branch and at this site, globally, mutations have increased the polarity of the residue. You see, most of the picture is white because, of course, there are not mutations everywhere. So when it's white, that means then there has not been any mutation and it has not changed the polarity. So basically, what the method I've shown you before, what it allows you to do is for a certain gene to reconstruct such a figure here that summarizes basically the history of biochemical change. And now what we want to do is to find positions in this big map that tends to display a compensating pattern. So that means that positions where when one position has a red at a certain point, a certain branch of the tree, then the other position will be blue and vice versa, reciprocally. So we have to do some kind of data mining here to be able to extract such position that show a significant compensating patterns. And to do that, we introduce a matrix that we call the compensation coefficient. And basically, this compensation coefficient, it's y minus the absolute value of the sum of change divided by the sum of the absolute value of changes. So to try to give you an idea, if you have two positions that are perfectly compensating, then the sum of their change will always be zero, because when one is negative, the other one is positive. So if they are perfectly compensating, the sum is always zero, and C is become then one minus zero in this one. On the other hand, if you have two positions that are always evolving in the same direction, so when one increases, the other increases. When one reduces, the other reduces. In that case, the absolute value of the sum will be exactly two times the sum of the absolute values. And in that case, the absolute value of the sum will be exactly the sum of the absolute value, and this ratio becomes one, and the compensation is zero. So you can see it in a way, it's very similar to a correlation coefficient. So when it's zero, there is no compensation at all, and when it's one, there is a perfect compensation. So we use this coefficient in a combination with a hierarchical clustering procedure in order to group positions based on their compensation patterns. And then we used a parametric bootstrap approach, to basically some simulations, in order to assess the significativity of this grouping. So these methods allows us then to exhibit coevolving position in a protein. But here we want to do a general statistical approach where we want to see which structural properties impact the occurrence of coevolution. So we did a bit like in the first part, a genomics approach where we tried to gather as many genes as possible for which we had a protein structure. So we started from a database of homologous sequences from completely sequenced genomes, and this database is called whole genome. And with this version of the database, we had only enough data in bacteria. So in the new version that we are currently analyzing, we will be able to add the eukaryotes, but in this version, we only had bacteria. There was not enough genomes in the other groups. So then we have a relatively complex pipeline, and that's because we really wanted to have top quality alignments. Just like when we look at adaptive evolution, when you want to look at coevolution, any error in the alignment can potentially bias your analysis. So we really wanted to ensure a top quality here. So we use different steps, including aligning with different algorithms. So aligning the proteins, aligning the DNA, and then taking a consensus alignment of the two, for instance. We also filtered the sequence based on their similarity. And once we have good enough alignment, we infer a phylogeny. And from the alignment and the phylogeny, then we make the substitution map and detect coevolving positions. So in the end, after a very stringent filtering, we kept 1,630 protein families for which we had a high quality alignment and a PDB structure. That's more than 360,000 positions. And just to give an idea, there's a bit less than 160,000 positions that are in alpha helices and a bit less than 70,000 positions that are in beta strands. So now, a few words that when we looked at coevolution, we looked at different biochemical properties. And there we used kind of the classic properties that are maybe the most well-known. That's the volume, the polarity, and the charge. But actually, if you look in the AA index database, which gathers all measured properties of amino acids, you have more than 500 entries. So there are more than 500 different properties of amino acids that have been set in this database. So, of course, many are very correlated. You have different measures of polarity, for instance. But some people have actually done a multivariate analysis of all these properties, and they showed that they can cluster basically in 8 groups. And so we also took the representative properties of each of these 8 groups. So that's with the hope that this represents a less biased view of what is possibly important as a property for an amino acid. So in total, we analyzed 11 biochemical properties. And so once we have run all these analyses, we found that more than 50,000 positions have a strong signal of coevolution for at least one property. So that's 14%. That's not that much, but it's still not zero. And we find that there is little overlap between the different biochemical properties. So when we tend to find a site coevolving for a certain property, then it's not found by another. So to give you an example of such of these positions that are detected, so here you have two sites that have been found to coevolve for charge. And there are different representations here to give an idea of this coevolution signal. So the first panel, A here, is just a representation of the substitution map. But instead of having made a heat map where I plotted all the branches, I just directly painted the phylogeny here. And so you can see that it's relatively clear on this case that when there is a blue branch on the left, or when a branch is blue on the first side, then it tends to be red on the second side. The B panel here is a detail of the branches with the most mutations. And you can see indeed that you have this perfect compensation or good compensation. When one position decreases the property, then the other one increases it. The first branch here, for instance, is a perfect example of compensation because it's a complete reciprocal mutation. So on the first site, you have a mutation from a K to an E, and on the second site, you have a mutation from an E to a K. You cannot have more perfect compensation. You change a positively charged residue into a negative one, and at the other position, you change a negative one into a positive one. The last panel here is a measure of the compensation, that is compensation index, but computed on the branch only. And you can see that the branches are sorted here by their signal of compensation. The compensation index is shown in red. And in blue, you have somehow kind of the expected distribution under the null hypothesis that the two positions would be evolving independently. And so you can see that for these two sites, there are like a dozen of branches where you see a clear evidence for a compensating mutation. Here is another example for volume compensation, and this time it involves 3 sites. So the signal is a bit more diluted here, but still you can see that, for instance, on this branch, you have been a mutation from a big residue into a small one, and this is compensated by 2 mutations of small residue toward a middle-sized residue at the first and third position. So these are 3 residues that are in contact. And on other branches, you see that you have one mutation at one site that's compensated by a mutation at another site, but it's not always the 2 same sites. Here it's site 2 and 3, here it's site 1 and 3, and then you have somewhere it's 2 and 3 again. And again, the C panel show you the level of compensation and the significance. Okay, so we have thousands of such sites, so I'm not going to show them all, but what we are interested in here is basically to see Where are those sites generally? What are the factors that make it likely to have a compensating mutation or not? And so to do that, we run a linear model where basically the response variable is whether you're coevolving or not. And it's a binary variable, so that gives you a logistic regression. And then we have a different explanatory variable, like the evolutionary rate of the site, the solvent exposure, whether it's in a secondary structure, the motif, and so on. And there is one more complication here, is that because we are analyzing simultaneously many sites, so more like 300,000, that are from different protein families, we somehow have to account for the possible effect of protein families, that two residues that are in the same protein family might be somehow correlated, just because, for instance, of statistical power, that there are more sequences in this family than in another one, or it's a bigger, the gene is longer, and so on. So we added the family effect as a possible confounding factor, and we added it as a random effect. So we basically used generalized linear models with mixed effect that are called GLMM. And such models are a bit more tricky to fit. So we had to compare different optimization algorithms. But the good news is that they gave extremely consistent results. So I can just present one result. And what we found is that if you first focus on the volume, polarity, and charge, that are maybe the most intuitive properties, what we find is that the most significant effects are actually the rate and the RSA. And it's most of all the rate, which is the most significant here. And we see that for volume and polarity, it has a negative effect. So that means that coevolving positions tend to evolve more slowly. Whereas for charge, it's the opposite. So residues that are coevolving for charge tend to evolve faster. And for RSA, we have in all cases a negative effect, which means that exposed residues are less likely to coevolve than the buried ones. We have globally little effect of secondary structure. Only residues in beta sheets tend to coevolve less than other residues. If we look at the other indices, it's more like generic properties. There we have also very consistent results. For the effect of rate, actually, it's a very significant and negative effect in all cases. So they are all coevolving residues tend to evolve slower than the average. The RSA is globally negative. But for a few indices, we have a positive effect. And we see again the effect of strand in secondary structure, that strands tend to have less coevolution than other secondary structure motif, or compared to residues that are not in secondary structure. Something interesting here is that the indice 3 is by far the one that has the most significant results, and with all variable, including secondary structure. That's the only one that really correlates with secondary structure. And a posteriori, it's not surprising. It's actually a nice control, because this indice is called alpha and turn propensities. So it is actually the propensity of a residue to form a secondary structure. So that's actually a nice validation here, that the only one that correlates with secondary structure, for which you see coevolution for this indice. Finally, we look at the tertiary structure. So there we had to do a bit of a different approach. We cannot analyze sites individually, but we have to look at groups of sites. And there we computed for all coevolving groups how many positions are physically in contact. And so you see that the proportion here in percent varies between properties, but in all cases, it is significantly higher than expected by chance. So that means that coevolving positions tend to be in contact in the 3D structure. So at the end of the second part and end of my talk, so the conclusion from this second part is that globally, the coevolving positions are relatively few. We said there was like 14% of coevolving positions. And generally, these positions tend to evolve slowly. So that basically means that globally, the compensating mutations are quite rare. We also found that there is generally less coevolution within a secondary structure motif, but that coevolving residues tend to be in proximity in 3D. And also for, it's not always true, but for most of them, they tend to be also buried, which suggests again a role for the connectivity of residues. And finally, the intriguing thing that we observed is that coevolution for charge seems to be to have a very different dynamic than coevolution for other properties. So that's something we would like to investigate in the future. One thing to maybe think about is that most of the other properties are like a bit like continuous traits. That's a full range of value if you think of the volume of a residue. Whereas the charge is more like a discrete trait, right? So positively negative, positively charged, negatively charged, or not charged at all. So maybe this creates a complete different dynamic that we still have to understand. And that's why not to summarize the two parts together. I hope that I could somehow convince you that the distribution of both adaptive and compensating mutations depend on the structure of the encoded macromolecules, and that the most important aspect of the structure is actually the tertiary structure and the propensity of residues to make interaction. I also hope that this will show you or provide a good example of how we can use statistical modeling to infer process of molecular evolution from the sequence only, but also that combining sequence data with other information like structure of proteins can really provide insight into the link between protein structure and sequence evolution. And finally, if I would say that I would try to summarize in one sentence what we have learned from these studies, I would say that then if you would ask the question, what is the effect of a mutation in a protein? Then I will say that what we've learned from here is that if this mutation is at the core of the 3D structure, then it's most likely deleterious, unless it compensates for another deleterious mutation. And then with this, I thank you for your attention, and I will be very happy to take any question if there are.
Thank you, Dr. Dutheil, for your talk. And if you have any question, you can type to the chat box. We have a question, and Rumeysa asked that AA index database is reliable. I mean, is it updated? Also, the database itself has redundant data, or it is non-redundant?
So it is updated, I don't know. I would say a priori yes. It's not like a sequence database, so you don't have that many new amino acid properties that are coming. So I think the database was mostly done based on the literature. You know, at some point, someone took all the literature survey and look at all the properties that have been measured and then structured that into a database. If there are some new measures that are done in the database, I don't know. I have actually not checked since some time and see if it has increased. For sure, it is highly redundant. That's sometimes it's a different measure of the same property, but with different experimental protocol. And that's why there was this work that was done at some point, which was to make a statistical analysis of all these properties to basically identify what are the non-redundant properties. And it, in the end, it boils down to 8. So you had more than 500 things, and you can see they really cluster in 8 groups. So it is for sure highly redundant.
Thank you. It looks like there is no question left. Then I would like to thank Dr. Dutheil again for his very nice and informative presentation. And thank you all for your participation to our webinar. Our next events will be announced on our Big Marker, Facebook, Twitter, and LinkedIn pages. Please register to BioInfonet community on Big Marker to receive our invitations. This is end of our webinar. Thank you all again, and have a nice day.
Thanks to you.